I had the chance to save the world, I would give it all I have. If I had the chance to change the world, I would do it with my heart on my hands. Watch me fly, watch me try, watch me be the greatest I can be on my own. I don't really care who's watching me, I'll be fine, I'll be fine, I'll be fine, yeah. Watch me fly, watch me try, watch me be the greatest I can be on my own. I don't really care who's watching me, I'll be fine, I'll be fine, I'll be fine, yeah. If I had a chance to change the world, I would let you know utaku wa sawa. If I had a chance to save the world, I would give it up for anything I have. Watch me fly, watch me try, watch me be the greatest I can be on my own. I don't really care who's watching me, I'll be fine, I'll be fine, I'll be fine, yeah. Watch me fly, watch me try, watch me be the greatest I can be on my own. I don't really care who's watching me, I'll be fine, I'll be fine, I'll be fine, yeah. Watch me fly, watch me try, watch me be the greatest I can be on my own. I don't really care who's watching me, I'll be fine, I'll be fine, I'll be fine, yeah.
Hi Hiach, I watch your documentaries. I have some ideas on distribution. Can we talk?
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where you're logging in from. Welcome to IFC, and we're so excited to have you. So today we're going to talk about Africa's creative industries, also known as the orange economy.
Yes, Greg. Africa's creative industry is booming. African movies are attracting the interest of not only Africans, but Hollywood, Bollywood, and more. And Africa's music is everywhere. So this is very key because we're observing more tech innovations in the space, which are creating career paths for young Africans.
Some of you may know, 2021 was actually declared the year of the creative economy for sustainable development. So today we're going to talk to creative industry leaders, creatives and executives from film, fashion, and more.
You are joining us on the Welcome platform. You may be new here, so let us give you a tour of how it works. First, we want you to be as engaged as possible, so drop your comments in the chat on the lower right.
Yes, and we know we have plenty of audience members from all over the world, so why don't you go to the comment section, say what city, what country you're joining us from, and our online moderators will be there to greet you.
On the top right, you have the Q&A tab. You can use it to ask questions to the speakers. Go ahead, drop your question, and everyone can vote for their favorite question.
And if you're having any technical difficulties, just click the Help tab on the top right, and someone will be there to help you right away. You can also follow this conversation on social media. Our online moderators will drop the links in the chat.
Towards the end of the event, we'll also have a poll. So watch out for Reina and Lauren, your online moderators, to tell you when it's time to answer your poll. But in the meantime, let's get started. Michaela, what's up next for us?
Let's start with music. Music has always been a part of our history. In the good times and the bad times, music has often shared our most significant moments. It's very much true for Africa. Its rich culture is reflected in the diversity of its musical story. Now, global demand for African music has been on the rise, and it will just go up from here. To tell us more about the opportunities and challenges of Africa's music industry, we're going to meet Sauti Sol in Kenya, a multi-award-winning band that will join IFC's managing director, Magda Diop, for a chat.
Habari.
Nzuri sana.
Asante sana. Tell us, how did you put this band together? What is the story of Sauti Sol?
The story of Sauti Sol is a bunch of good friends who were classmates in high school and decided that we can be now life mates. We are married for the last
15 years to each other.
Yeah. We've been playing music together for the last 15 years.
Yeah.
And it's been a journey of ups and downs, but we are really grateful. We have had a lot of fun playing music and just sharing our gift and doing beautiful things.
Sure.
Yeah, it's been an amazing, like, you know, a marriage of four individuals who are very different yet so in tandem in thought and in legacy. And it's just been a good journey getting people, finding people who work with us, people who we align with, people who, like, we disagree with. And I think the life process, and it's just a journey, and we are happy and we are thankful for that. It's not easy, but life.
What happened special to Sauti Sol? Because when I was there, you are a very talented musician in Kenya, Mercy, Mara with a fantastic voice. You had Eric Wainana, you had what's her name? Susan Ovio. But you know, you took it to the next level. You took it to the next level from what I can see in your production. What did you do differently from your elders?
Well, I think first and foremost, it's just important that as a people, as a civilization, we always get better with every generation. And I would say that we would not be who we are if our elders didn't do what they had to do. You know, like I actually just heard the song you did with Masimaira.
Yeah.
And we were remembering, like, how as kids, that song really, really was an amazing, like, piece of art that nourished us and inspired us now to become the people we are today. So I think just by sheer our existence, we've been able to raise the bar, and we are also expecting that the coming generations will raise the bar by just being themselves and being authentic and staying true to their craft.
One of the things that often I've seen before coming to Kenya, I was in my own country in Senegal, and in my position, I pushed for copyrights. Actually, it was quite unusual because I was minister for finance, and usually minister for finance are not looking into music. So my peers were listening, what are you putting your nose in music? But I was, my conviction is that because I love music, it's something that I like, enjoy. But secondly, it was clear for me that it was a job creation and activity and a significant source of income of industry for the youth. So it was important to have a framework that to make a company. So one of the things that we did, and actually we did it with the bank at that time, was to revisit all the copyright laws. And it changed the governance of the copyright body, which was public, to make it really now in the hand of the musician so that they can ensure that. So what has been the evolution in Kenya and on this, and what are your views on the legal framework, copyright laws and regulations?
I mean, first of all, I have to commend you what you've done back at home. It's amazing what you've done, because these problems that you had are the same things that we are facing right now, or we've been facing for many years when it comes to copyright. And I mean, yeah, it's kind of also showing people the value of music as a career, and the policy holders, unfortunately, some of them do not see it that way. And it's something, it's a fight that we've been, trying to win, or rather, we know we're gonna win, of course, very soon, but it's a process, it's a journey. And we hope for the best for that, and we hope to even get in places where we can be the policymakers and make sure that, because copyright, I mean, it transcends across generations, and it's our kids and our kids' kids that will really suffer if we don't sort this out now. Mm-hmm. So it's up to us to make sure that everything is aligned, and there's so many even kind of cases in court right now when it comes to our governing bodies in terms of copyright right now. And I mean, that shows that things are going to change, and it's a good sign, yeah.
But I think that I think two things that might be useful moving forward. First of all, to share with you what we did, and maybe to if you don't have yet this contact among African artists who are struggling with the same issues, to maybe encourage you and maybe facilitate if you can. The exchange of laws that have been applied in our countries that might be relevant, and try just to foster that what I would say is the South-South cooperation. One of the things that I would love to hear from you is that some of the artists have told me that now with the digital way of distribution of music, which is becoming the main way of distributing music, one can make some leapfrogs and be able to use this technology to be able to better secure a copyright by reducing the ability to copy CDs. In my time, you would buy a CD with 12 songs. Now I understand that it's totally outdated. You don't buy 12 songs. You just buy the song you like and the two songs you like, and you put it on your iPhone and you listen to it. How do you see the use of technology to help you really on your copyright discussion?
It's a beautiful time to be an artist. I think artists are making the most money they've ever made now from music sales and record sales. What happened during what happened before in previous years was that the distribution was handled by the major labels. So access to your music was limited to the different territories where your label represented you, or where you were able to, just by independently get your music to. However, right now, with the music online and with distribution being done online and with digital sales being the dominant way of us guys getting our revenues from our music, at least you can assure yourself that every artist who is working hard and is in a good contract is getting paid. Also, it's been very easy also right now, because of digital sales, to track the royalty allocation to the rights holders of the music. So very delicate, parts of copyright, like, the publishing side of things, and these things that were in the past not really recognized are being recognized. Session musicians are getting their money. If you played guitar in a song, if you played bass in a song, you're getting paid right now. You're getting paid by your publisher is following up on your check, and you're getting a check. And what you're gonna see in the future I think after the more we keep on educating our artists, because I know information is power, the more you'll realize that now artists are going to become more and more independent, and there's going to be very many more art millionaires. But I think Kenya is in the right track, and Africa is in the right track as well.
Now, guys, you know, I'm here, as you can see, I'm passionate about music. It's not my
100%. 100%.
You're our guy now.
100%. 100%.
Yes, you're the man.
I can appreciate really the importance of it. I think for many reasons. I think that it's a social builder. It's influenced people much more than anything else, because this is touching to your emotion. How many things you find yourself thinking something in the shower, and just those lyrics come back to us all the time. You've seen all the emancipation of Black people in the US have been coming from music. You take the fight against apartheid, it was in the music. So this is something that for me is very important. And lastly, it mobilizes the youth. I would like to push my institution, IFC, to try to look at how we can work more closely with the creative industries and see what we can do and look at options and opportunities. Thank you so very much for giving me the chance to know you and to chat with you. You're doing great, and we are very proud of your success, and keep on the great work.
Up next, we have a jam session from Saudi Soul, who gave us exclusive behind-the-scenes access as they rehearse for their upcoming tour.
Culture and art are Africa's biggest export.
Yes.
So what do you feel is needed in terms of the structure now to make this sustainable?
Three things. The first one is policy.
Okay.
The second one is policy.
Okay.
And the third one is policy.
Okay. Yes.
Policy is the most important thing. Policy. Because, you know, like, policy just makes everything function.
True.
Policy gives everybody like a level playing field and builds a system of equity and credibility. Mm-hmm. Policy makes sure all of the people in the value chain are respected in financially, mm-hmm. and just respected in terms of their command, what they command.
Gives a fair playing field.
Yeah, mm-hmm. and policy makes sure that as an industry, we get the rates we deserve for mm-hmm. the services that we give. Mm-hmm. So I think that, for me,
it's true, man. It's only policy that decides we're gonna play this kind of percentage of local content.
Yeah,
it's only policy. So
and it's policy that makes broadcasters have to pay
for the content
that they play.
Yeah.
but they refuse to pay sometimes.
So what about investment?
Yeah, investment.
Financing.
But look at South Korea. They put 1% of their GDP in the arts. Right now, K-pop is number one in the world. K-drama is number one in the world. K-movies are winning.
They bring in like literally billions of dollars in BTS into the economy, you know?
For the Korean economy.
Yeah.
That is a policy issue.
Yeah.
Where there is good policy, a government that has good policy puts their funds aside for art.
Mm-hmm.
Governments that have good policy take care of the artists. A country that takes care of its artists is culturally advanced.
It shouldn't be so difficult for me to travel to Bamako just to enjoy music and culture and to just integrate. It should be easy. So,
imagine, how come we've never been to Ivory Coast? You know, like, it's a shame.
What are you waiting for?
It's a shame. But it's so difficult to travel within Africa. Yeah, it is
true.
The most difficult exercise. It's expensive.
Yeah. It's
that's
true.
Policy.
That's true. True.
I feel like give power to the young people. Give power to the young people who can run these associations, who can make structures that can run. Because right now we are in a very technological world. Right now things are run on mobile, you know? So the young people are willing. They just want the way. Give them power. You'll see fire.
That's a really good word for the end. Thank you so much, Guy.
I think this is
the right time to put the conversation and continue with how to move forward with creative industry.
Yep.
Asante sana.
Thank you.
Thank you. Asante ni sana.
Merci beaucoup.
Merci à vous tous.
Both of you being leaders in the music industry and working with artists that impact millions of people. So what inspired the creation of Afrikaan?
So what inspired the creation? At that time, I was based in South Africa, and a few friends and colleagues that I've met while being based here asked me about helping them with digital distribution. I already worked in that space for a few years before that, so I was connecting them with distributors around the world. I quickly realized that the distributors were not providing the service that the people here were needed. And so we decided to look at, okay, if we were to create a service and a company that provides services to artists and independent labels in the continent, how should it look like?
So Fiona, what prompted Spotify coming to Africa?
Spotify coming to Africa has always been in the sights of the company. I think Spotify's ambition has been demonstrated with the way that we've been aggressively growing across, you know, we're the biggest streaming service in the world. And to continue being that way, you have to reach every corner of the world. Africa being, first of all, the continent with the largest youth population in the world, it would only make sense for us to bring a music service to a predominantly young demo, because, you know, young people and music, that obviously goes hand in hand. I often get the question that why did it take so long for Spotify to get to Africa? And for that, I always say, you know, Africa is not one country, as we know. And with the diversity of talent, the diversity of cultures, the diversity of audience, you would have to take the time that it takes to, you know, to understand it. You have to take the time to get the right team in place to service it. I mean, right now, we are very blessed to be able to have a team that represents West and East and Southern Africa. We have AOP and when I say ALP, artist and label management teams, and we have editorial teams that can speak specifically to those territories, which is extremely important. We can move fast, but I think our ambition was to move properly and launch correctly. And thankfully, in February of this year, I think we managed to pull that off quite successfully. And we're looking forward to further expansion into other parts of the world. To answer your question, what is the role of the African right now? I think that we are definitely becoming exponentially influential on pop mainstream. I think that at this stage, we are still talking about specific names here and there, but I think in not so far down the line, we're going to see genres being reinvented. We're going to see cultures cross-pollinating, and it's going to be great. Like, I think it's just going to be that much easier for our music to be, it won't seem so exotic and foreign in even now, like I don't feel, especially with the onset of the internet. And I think that was the, I think that was the big trigger of why, or how come African music has gone from being, you know, niche and for us only in our weddings and parties and whatever, and now, you know, Tems and Wizkid and Davido and Cruel Santino and Odunsi, all of these are names that are signed to the biggest major labels with very substantial deals, because everyone can now see it's quite clear that the demand is high and the world seems ready for the dominance of African music in pop.
And Yoa, what's your take on the African music trends?
I mean, there's two things to say. I think the on the African music trend, what is really interesting and what has really changed in the last few years is that the conversation has shifted. When we used to try to get media or even the top curators or DSPs around the world to be interested in African music, it used to be pigeonholed. It started from even before that as world music, and then we completely killed that space. I mean, now we're not even talking about African music and world music, it's finished. But I just came back, I was 3 months traveling now, even during COVID, and you're in New York with, you talk about Amapiano, you talk about African music, people want to know. We have people calling us internationally about, what do you have? How interesting it is. You know, it's like it's different. It's not that we were beggars, but now we're much more at the center of those conversations.
So if you had a wish list for a financial institution like IFC, what would that be?
If I had a wish list, if they were to give me money to solve the problems of the world, I'd buy a house. No. The first thing I would do or ask for is somebody to invest to create the access for everyone in Africa to access the internet for free. That's the first thing I would ask for. And for me, I can almost liken it to my personal story. My career would never have existed if digital didn't exist. I was a self-starter from the beginning. You know, I was a blogger, a writer, all these kinds of things, but I always worked for myself. And I was able to do that because of the internet. And I think that access is the one thing that our continent, that's the only thing that keeps us from being able to play on the same level as the rest of the world. So that would be the first thing I would ask for. I don't know what, Joel, I don't know what Yoli would.
No, it's actually a very good point. There's like grants to take a few, 20, 25 people to Hollywood to present the music, to meet the music supervisors in Hollywood who deals, who handles all the big movies and or smaller movies or, you know, the big shows, TV shows as well. Those type of initiatives help to accelerate the business. And we need to look at how, you know, what foundations and what acceleration we need to build a homegrown music business, and then how to help, again, accelerate the trends that we're seeing now, which is taking African music to the world. So those are the two things.
I actually wanted to add to Yoel's point, because I just remembered you'd asked me about challenges that we at Spotify had experienced when we were launching. And it's there's one particular one which is still ongoing, and that's the cost of the data, right? So if it's hard for your audience to stream, then it's hard for you to make money on streaming. If everybody can stream, that's literally the way that the streaming as a business model works. You know, we need to have as many people, as many consumers as possible on all the streaming service. Doesn't matter who. I'm not even talking just about Spotify. I'm just talking in general, and just completely make that the only way that music can be accessed. What now is happening is, for example, and I'm going to go back to Amapiano because this is the you know, it's the genre of the moment. But they have a tendency within that community to not really consider streaming as the first place where the music will go. A lot of free download sites have access to the content from Amapiano community, and what that does, it compromises the opportunity for streaming for the artists, for the labels, and for people who would otherwise be able to make an income there. So it's all pretty related. But if somebody can just give us all the access, I think that would be a beginning.
No, it's and I've got, you made me think, I've got one thing that could be straight to the IFC and the World Bank, and possibly not, I mean, I'm sure it's difficult, but not too difficult, is to, I think it would be great to, with some of the economists that you have, to look at the impact of the creative community in Africa. What is the impact in terms of job creations, the impact in terms of what is really the impact of music and the creative community in this continent? It's a place where we're missing a lot of data. And I think that the traditional businesses don't look at the creative business as a serious business. When you look at it in the UK or in Europe, we can see the impact of creative and the music industry to the UK economy, to the European economy. Besides the importance of art and creative into your identity as a nation or as a continent, but straight in terms of economical impact that the industry can do. And maybe the IFC and the World Bank can join forces with some people from the industry to work on an amazing survey that will help investors as well, looking at the importance of what we do.
That was an amazing conversation. So what I got is education, local innovations, and collaborations from global platforms like Spotify are going to be key in taking Africa's creatives to the next level.
From IFC, and welcome to another IFC Up Next segment. In this panel, we'll explore the tech innovations that are taking place in Africa's music industry by speaking with Boomplay, one of the major players in the streaming space. Personally, I'm a huge fan of Afropop and Afrobeats, so very excited to present to you our panel with Martha Hero from Boomplay and Bill Sonneborn from IFC to discuss Boomplay and the music industry of Africa.
Thanks, Yara. And Martha, welcome to this session. Why don't we start off with just telling us a little bit about Boomplay, a little bit about the history. You know, streaming is new on the continent, but it's growing quite rapidly.
Thank you very much for the introduction. And also, it's an honor to be here. So Boomplay is the number one music and video streaming and download service in the African market. We have presence in Kenya, Nigeria, Ghana, Tanzania, and we recently opened an office in Cote d'Ivoire. With these developments, we've seen the platform grow. Currently, we are at 60 million plus, as mentioned by Ara, users on the platform. as well as over 60 million songs on the platform. So these numbers keep on growing rapidly.
Thank you. You know, I mentioned this before, but Africa has some of the highest mobile data costs of any place on Earth. And it also has the fewest Wi-Fi hotspots and coffee shops or restaurants or stores per capita of any other continent. As you think about, for example, your partnership with Airtel Nigeria on the Airtel Boomplay streaming data plan, how are you thinking, given low incomes, a 1.3 billion population, some monopolistic, which we're trying IFC to solve, monopolistic kind of network operators from a mobile perspective, really solve this issue of access and inclusion to bring more people onto your platform?
Africa doesn't have a unified currency like a dollar or a euro. So we use different currencies in different countries. So that has always been a challenge in terms of payment systems that will integrate the local currencies or make sure that it's easy for the user to consume or maybe buy a subscription without using like a global currency like the ones that I've just mentioned. So what we did is we partnered with various payment platforms like Flutterwave, PalmPay, M-Pesa, Tigo Pesa, just to ensure mobile money, basically, just to ensure that we create a very smooth and convenient way of the users consuming music. Now, the partnership with Airtel, as you rightfully said, the data costs are off the roof in most of the African countries. So it was just a way of us finding a solution to ensure that the users have a bundle that they can use to consume music without really going deeper into their pockets. And of course, we're exploring other telco partnerships. So it's not only Airtel. So watch out for this space.
It perfectly makes sense because mobile money, I mean, when I think about, you know, Spotify deciding to enter the continent or, you know, the struggles Apple Music had.
It's very hard. They don't even trust the system when you tell them, give me your credit, debit card details. That's automatically a red flag. And mobile money is something that they use in their everyday life. So why not bring it down to what they use so it's convenient? Because music, if you look at it, is a luxury. So not everybody would want to consume it at the time at all times. So we are always trying to find strategies to ensure that it's convenient for them to consume music in their everyday life.
Thank you. There's been a lot of capital flowing into the creator tech space over particularly the last 5 years, which are technology solutions to allow artists, musicians, influencers to figure out different ways to monetize their presence, if you will. How do you see the future of music streaming as you kind of evolve as a platform and dealing with issues like piracy and the like? How do you see Boomplay, kind of evolving over time? And then how do you think your customers will all evolve over time in Africa?
I mean, being that piracy is the main challenge, we're looking into various ways to address this issue through technology. And the development of the NFT, we're very keen on that because we're seeing ways on loopholes on how we can use technology to ensure that the artist monetizes their musical works. So they earn more and they also get to reach more people in the continent. I mean, it's blood, sweat and tears when they create this content and then somebody just sits somewhere on a laptop and pirates it. But with the technology and also blockchains, like you just mentioned, there's a hope in terms of increasing the monetization value of their craft. I mean, streaming is the future. But last year during the pandemic, you know, some dreams were shattered because the main source of income from content creators is, you know, like artists is through shows and performances. But this was shut down because, I mean, the pandemic came. But this also created an opportunity for, you know, the people in the industry just coming up with new ways to ensure that they still make music and people still listen to it. So streaming came into play, and last year we actually saw a 200% increase in our streams. So that shows that, the new ways of streaming and live work, and it's nice to see that they're earning from another different type of income apart from shows and live. And also merchandising, I mean, people got very creative very fast, which was enlightening. So, I mean, it's safe to say that streaming is the future, and with the help of technology and technology advancement, it's a bright, bright future.
And it's a lot easier on the artists because they don't have to travel to 100, cities. They can do one performance and go to all 100 simultaneously. When you think about that with technology and the creative industries, I'm going to ask you a broader question than just music streaming, because as you know, this UpNext series focuses on all aspects of performing, visual arts, fashion. And you think about the intersection of technology, similar to how you've been able to use streaming technology to launch Boomplay into the leader in Africa. Where do you think the opportunities are to invest?
I mean, the opportunities are many. Like there's a survey that was done by GSMA and World Bank in sub-Saharan Africa. The mobile industry contribution to GDP is projected to reach a whooping $184 billion in 2024. And SIM connections are projected to reach $1.05 billion in 2025 with a compound annual growth rate of 4.3%, which is quite impressive, within a short time, 2019 to 2025. And also within the areas where we have physical presence, like in Nigeria, it's projected, the music industry is projected to become a $10 billion US dollars market by 2023, which is something to look forward to. So there's a future. Look at Ghana, Kenya and Tanzania. The markets are forecasted to rise, with a compound annual rate of 19.8%, 10.3% and 18.3% respectively, which is quite impressive if you ask me. There's a future for this industry, and with such data to project, I mean, I believe that the industry, if we are able to reach these projections, it will be quite phenomenal. And of course, with this, we require a lot of funding and also patience, because it's not an overnight thing. So, there's a bright future for this.
It's a very good point. I just this past weekend, I finished watching Squid Games, and would have ever thought.
I haven't watched it, but I'm hearing a lot of things. So I will definitely watch it now.
Who would have ever thought that a Korean produced series with subtitles becomes the number one streamed video in the United States? But perhaps where we're missing the fact that not everyone's born with the gene to code. Maybe they're born with the gene to sing. And this is an opportunity on the other, using the other side of people's brains to help solve the challenge of global poverty.
I hope you enjoyed the previous conversations. It's so insightful to learn about the opportunities in Africa's music sector and what we can all do to help and support it. Now, let's talk about the power of storytelling. The opportunity to share the African story in film has come after decades of tremendous efforts from creatives across the continent. In this segment, we'll hear about Disney's newest animation based in futuristic Nigeria, opportunities in Nollywood, and stories from writers and producers in Senegal, Egypt, and more. Enjoy.
I don't understand.
We cannot know. No, we cannot. I think.
But I'm looking for his phone. Is that his phone? Is that it? Can I just quickly
see? Oh.
We are ready to go, then. And your mother has refused to pack her things and come.
I thought we agreed you were going to okay.
Don't say that. You told me that we have to run. That it is better that I go to Uke. But did you hear me agree? Did I say O to you?
You want to come with us to Uma here then? Huh?
But why are you running? Where are you running to? Can you hear any guns?
Mama, people are fleeing Abagana and Ukpo, which means the Hausa soldiers are close and will soon enter Aba.
Who am I running away from my own house for? Do you know that your father will be cursing us now?
Mama, you cannot stay here. There will be nobody left in Aba.
The news is not good. The Hausa soldiers are close. I'm leaving for Uke. Send word when you get to Umai.
Had a few groundbreaking moments, first of which was the reality TV show. This was done by Ansel Malta Box Office, and it was for actors, basically. And that sort of launched me into the market, so I didn't have to, you know, defend or prove to my parents and to people that I could do this, because that spoke for itself. And after that, the first film I made off of the reality TV show with Ansel Malta, I had this, you know, incredible award that I won, and that award, you know, was an Africa Movie Academy Awards, and that sort of positioned me a bit more, you know, seriously in the industry. So I wasn't looking like a newcomer anymore. And then the third point was going off to study in LA. You know, for me, that was important because, you know, I'd seen how we made film in Nigeria, and it was important for me to, you know, I guess, translate the gift into some sort of knowledge base, basically. And then by the time I came back and I did this other film and I won another award, these awards were pretty crucial because they set me up enough to be able to be celebrated across parts of Africa that helps you become a more visible face. I think one of the biggest gaps is really, you know, building a structure, you know, specifically in Nigeria, but, you know, by extension in parts of Africa that have film markets, because this structure makes it easier for investors to come in, you know, whether it is based on policies, based on co-productions, those structures are important to be in place so that these conversations are important or are easier to have. You know, whether it is you decide that you want to work with people who come from outside or just to set up the structure for you guys to function properly in your own environment. So I think so far, you know, financing has been a serious challenge because, again, it's people pulling monies out of their pockets and hoping that something will happen. And I do think that as much as I know, there are structures we can build that facilitates, and this is, in my opinion, where a lot of the government comes in play. Because in my little experience, even in places like Brazil and Sao Paulo, where I've been fortunate to do some business, you know, I know that one of the bigger topics for filmmakers was that their president was changing the way the government was financing or funding film. And for me, that was funny because that's not the experience we have back home. And so when you have governments in Brazil set up SESC, which allows for all the creatives to find a space to be able to do this, sometimes you hope that this is something that, you know, governments in Africa can also look into, because ultimately our business, when you think about, you know, tax credits that, you know, places like here always give, you know, to filmmakers and things, those are aspects that can come from individuals, will come from governmental organizations and commercial banks. And clearly, there are, you know, there are very many ways you can structure these deals that allow for filmmakers to not be afraid to approach you so that you're not worried that you will spend the next 5, 6, 7, 10 years figuring out how to plug the money back into the system. Because again, our business is dicey, you know, and I understand that we have to be able to set it up as, you know, business that has numbers,
But the only way we can start from where we are is by getting as much plug-in, in my opinion, from the government as much as we can. And, you know, ramping up the policies that allow for filmmakers to be able to find the spaces to do this so that financing is not the issue for us to be able to tell these stories.
Good evening, good afternoon, good morning. My name is Mo Abudu, and I am the Chief Executive Officer of the Ebony Life Group. And the Ebony Life Group consists of Ebony Life Studios, Ebony Life Media, the Ebony Life Creative Academy, and Ebony Life Place. And Ebony Life Place is where we're shooting this piece today, and it's home to Ebony Life Cinemas, it's home to the White Orchid Hotel, it's home to Turaka, our rooftop restaurant, and it's also home to Ginger Lagos, our Asian fusion restaurant as well. So yes, that is who I am. My journey has been an exciting one. I started, you know, my media career after I just turned 40. So a few people felt I was sort of having a life, you know, a midlife crisis, which I wasn't. I just knew instinctively that telling our stories and having a strong narrative was going to be extremely important to us as Nigerians, as Africans, as a continent, as a global Black individual. And I knew that I had to do something. And that something for me was starting my talk show, which became the anchor for so many, many more things. And, you know, it commenced with Moments with Mo, and then came a couple of other shows that I produced. And then the big one was obviously Ebony Life Television, and then came Ebony Life Films. To the point where we are now in 2021, we are the first African production company to have signed a multiple deal with Netflix. We are also the first African production company to have about 30 international projects in development. So we are extremely excited about the future and telling authentic African stories to a global audience. I think the opportunities for investment are massive. I mean, the inroads are basically, we're still at a grassroots level. The opportunities that we have experienced in the last few years are based on the fact that there is an emergence, there is a consciousness, there is a need to tell our stories. Story is story. It doesn't matter where in the world you come from. People just want a narrative that they can relate to and they can buy into. And I think commercially, what's happened around the world is that storytelling has become something whereby it's become the same, the same, the same. And everybody now wants a sense of freshness to the stories that they want to be told. I mean, if we take, for example, now the new Netflix blockbuster, Squid Game, which was made for a local Korean audience, has now become a global phenomenon. Simply because it's original, simply because it's authentic. And it wasn't even made in the English language. You can watch it obviously with subtitles or a dub, but it tells you the importance of story, story, story. So I think that the opportunities for investment are huge. We haven't begun to touch the tip of the iceberg. And we're happy to be one of the production companies and studios that's at the forefront of building and telling the African narrative and empowering many in front of the screen and behind the screen and telling our stories and pushing that out there. It's only just the beginning. So the commercial numbers are going to make so much sense for audiences around the world. We're excited to be, you know, at the forefront. And when we look at what's happening globally with all the streamers, they all need to have a percentage of content that comes from the continent. So therefore, it's the opportunities are just are massive. Investors need to look at the African creative sector as a viable market because it is a market that hasn't been explored. We know that, you know, all banks, all financial institutions have an emerging market desk. We all know that the return on investment is always way higher when it's in an emerging market. And this is still an emerging market. It is the right time for investors to say, I want to be in on this journey. I want to be a part of this journey because it's all still so new and still so fresh. It's the right time to be at it and to be in it. Well, I think it speaks for itself that there is a future to African content being successful within our continent because we want to see stories that we can relate to. It's important for me to see me. It's important for others to see me, to have respect for me, to understand my tradition, to understand my ways and my nuances, to understand my stories that have never been told. So I think definitely there's an appetite for great and good storytelling. And for us at Ebony Life, we have built four key genres that we think the world is going to buy into. There's Afro history, which is going back in time and exploring all those incredible stories like the Dahomey Warriors with our partnership with Sony. Then there's Afro Impact, which is looking at things that are impactful, that impact us as a continent and those around the world. And that would, if we look at a project like Oloture, that was the most watched Nigerian film on Netflix in 2020, again, it tells you the importance of impactful storytelling, like human trafficking. The third genre is Afropolitan, which is telling day-to-day stories, like the wedding party, you know, Chief Daddy, Your Excellency. It's dealing with my day-to-day reality. You know, these stories get told by studios around the world. So why is my day-to-day story less important than your day-to-day story? And the fourth is Afrofuturism. So if you take a story like Nigeria 2099, which is a partnership with AMC, it talks about a scarcity of resources in the continent and the fight for those resources. And we've seen that happen time and time again. It's just that this story is now set in 2099 in a futuristic society. We know the world is brought into the sci-fi genre. And it's important that we can also, you know, have our own rightful place in that storytelling as well. My advice is take what I have done. It's to invest in content development. It's to invest in storytelling. It's to invest in building the team. It's to invest in pitching these stories to global studios around the world. It's to get them to buy in. And it doesn't happen overnight. You know, it's a continual conversation. It's about being in the room and telling those stories all the time. And, you know, they are biting, which is why I can sit here and say to you that we do have 30 international projects in development. With our partners. We do have a whole slate with Netflix. So I can sit here and say that because we have done it and we are doing it. My response to that is capacity building. You know, and again, Ebony Life is at the forefront of doing this for our continent and doing this for Nigeria and doing this for Lagos. So during the time of the administration's agenda building and trying to identify the projects that would have benefit for Lagos was the need for capacity building. And the Creative Academy, the Ebony Life Creative Academy, was an idea that we had had, and we had had discussions with several governments, but nobody had the foresight to buy into it. But this particular administration did. We launched the Academy in March 2021. We have had two graduations of 240 students so far. Every year, we're training 480 students in producing, in script writing, in directing, in cinematography, in sound and audio post-production, and they're going out into the workforce. Now, what gives me the greatest joy is that one of our students, Genoviva Ume, who came in as an acting student, is now going to be in a major Netflix production. You know, and it tells you that there are no limits to what can happen with the right amount of training. So the future is capacity building and developing that skills force, and that will definitely take us into the global space that we need to be a part of.
Africa's creative industries have found new global appeal due to the uptake in streaming services as well. In 2020, Nollywood generated 1 million jobs and more than $7 billion for the Nigerian economy.
Yes, streaming platforms are expected to reach 5 million African consumers by the end of the year. In this next conversation, IFC investment analyst Ngozi Okwenny will have a conversation with Hamid Ibrahim, production designer for Disney Plus's new animated series, Waju.
My name is Ngozi Okwenny. I'm an investment analyst with IFC, and I'm part of the team exploring the Africa creative industry. I'm happy to chat with you today, and thank you so much for joining us. I am Nigerian, and I know how much pain it takes to convince our family and friends to pursue a career in arts or creative industry. So I really want to hear about your background. So tell me, how was it growing up? Did you always know you wanted to get into the art industry? And how did your family and friends react? Did you get as much support as you expected? So tell us a little bit about your background. Thank you.
My background is actually very interesting. I'm one of those people where if you run through the whole story, it looks like it was written. In that the thing that got me interested in art itself was, because I was born in Uganda, then I grew up a few years in Kenya. At this point, I was in Kenya for about 10 years there. I was in Kenya really young. And there was an advert on TV, I think it was a water bottle. I know how adverts go, they don't really show you what's going on, right? Now, yeah. A thing came up was Mona Lisa, much more than just art. Now, that image of the Mona Lisa, somehow, you know when an image just captures you? That image just really, really captured me. And I went and researched Mona Lisa, I saw Da Vinci, and if you know Da Vinci's life, it's very incredible.
Yeah, Da Vinci.
So that was the first thing that really got me into art.
Thanks for sharing that with us. As a young person working on such a big, amazing Disney Plus project, tell us a little bit more about the project. Do you think, I see it's going to be launched soon, the Iwaju project. How does that feel to be telling the story of the African people?
Feels amazing, because that's, you know, you take a risk and it pays off. That's what happened with this project. What I'm doing now is actually a bit smaller. It's less of a risk than that first jump of leaving the job of my dreams to go and start doing something just to try and build something for back home, for Africa. I think it was an Elon Musk quote. He was like, if something is important enough, you do it even if the odds are not in your favor. So it's one of the things where the odds were definitely not in my favor. I was like, I'm just going to give it the best shot I can give it. And whatever comes out, we do that. If it fails, I can easily come back to my career. That was the mentality I had.
You both are featured on Netflix and Disney Plus, some of those global distribution platforms. So tell us a little bit in your experience, do you think that these platforms are able to bring more grace to the African content? And also, do you think it bodes well for the future of the African creative industry?
That's an interesting question. Funny enough, we think about that a lot in Kigali, because it goes both ways, where there's a big advantage and a big disadvantage. The advantage is exposure, right? And people can now see how good African stories actually are. So this is allowing us to actually look at the art form as an art form in itself. So there's that advantage. Also the advantage of people getting paid what they're worth. But now that one has a direct disadvantage in that, as Kigali, as you know, our goal is not to just like eat ourselves. It's more, we're very collaborative. So we work with a lot of artists from Africa. And the whole idea, we want to bring up the whole industry. I've come across a problem where there are some artists, we have artists interviewed, where one of them literally said, I cannot work for any studio back home that can't afford to pay me. And that really hurt. I was like, that means all the talent is now going outside. Even if it's working on an African-related project, right? It's that thing where I'm like, is that going to kind of cripple the industry in some kind of way? So it's good and it's bad. And let's see what happens. Obviously, we're going to try our best to make sure everything stays on track and becomes as amazing as it can be. But there's definitely a concern there of that imbalance of the people who get into, let's say, the Western money, which converts very highly when you're back home. right? Yeah. And then all of a sudden, maybe they don't want to work on the average small studio back home. So there's that thing there that's a bit of a worry for me. That's me as a business person.
What key initiatives do you think Africans can adopt, or what key initiatives can we put in place as an industry to make sure that we take advantage of this opportunity that has been presented to tell the African story all around the world? What initiatives come to your mind that can be put in place?
I think the first one would be education. Just try and find a way for people to get into the creative industry that's valid. So in other words, we need to create more creators, because if there's more people creating, it kind of helps. It solves the first problem right away, in that if, let's say, there's 10 3D modelers in the whole of the continent, they can kind of push their price up and they'll always go to the highest bidder. But if there is 1,000, it's going to be a lot more spread out, a little bit more. And that also allows us from back home to create something really of high quality. So number one would be to make sure we create more artists and more storytellers, artists, everything, more creatives in general. We make sure we do that. Not even just creatives, I would say another one is learning from the leadership of the people outside. So for example, in the Disney project, I'm learning, like I take notes in every single day, or not every day, but any day anything special happens, anything unique happens, I take a note of that as like a learning moment, and I kind of go through it, just because the opportunity to be with the highest people in the Disney industry, this is the biggest studio in the world, right? If I'm not learning as much as I possibly can, that's just, because Africa has a lot of creatives. I think where we have a hole is creative leadership, and I'm trying to be the best I can be in that area. And that's another area. So education, just getting as many creative as possible, creative leadership. And then another one, let's not drop the ball, man. Let's make some amazing stuff. Let people celebrate it. That's pretty much it. The world is changing so much right now. There is so much happening right now. And usually when that happens, that's when there's opportunities for people to move up really, really fast. In that, one, I know people right now back home, a lot of people have internet, but I think it's predicted in, I think, a few years, the number of people with internet in Africa is going to explode, because a lot of Africa doesn't have internet yet, right? We don't think about that. We think about the cities. And if the other people get the internet, that's one factor that's really going to accelerate a lot of things. That's just one thing. There's so many things happening right now, and I think Africa is going to be in a very good position to capitalize on that. So I'd say if there's ever a time to take risks, it's right now. The world is it's not solid. Nothing is set. Like the Goliaths of the next years are not set yet. So this is like the time to actually put yourself and become one of those Goliaths at this time, because of how fast the world is changing. Like look at the just film industry itself, right? Like cinemas and streaming, that's completely loose. We don't even know how streaming is going to look. Right now, we just have the normal streaming, right? You think about other forms of entertainment. We have TikTok now, right? Somebody from back home with a phone right now could literally just from TikTok, like how viral the algorithm works. There's so many things right now. I think jump on as many as possible, the ones that obviously interest you. And this is actually a chance for you to, it's not just you yourself, but just legacy-wise, if you hit the right one at this point of time in history, it's going to stay for a very long time.
Now, beyond Nollywood, other African countries also have a lot to offer.
We'll check in with Hai, an Egyptian filmmaker who uses her films for social cohesion and cultural understanding.
My name is Hayat, and I'm a 23-year-old Egyptian filmmaker. I'm speaking to you today from Amman, Jordan, where I've just finished shooting a Disney Plus series I've been working on for about a year. Now, a little bit about me. When I was 9 years old, I started practicing my Oscar speech. I know, but my parents had this little piece of furniture that had a tiny mirror just my size, and I would pass in front of it and practice my speech. I knew all the words to Grease, and not just the songs, even the dialogue. I was determined that I would work in film one day, even though I was teased for it quite a bit, filmmaking not being considered a notable career choice in Egypt. But that didn't stop me. And a few years later, I moved to New York City, and my eyes still sparkled at the idea of becoming an actress one day. But as one of the only diverse students in my new school, I started focusing more on a new passion of mine, social justice. And so I became interested in topics from global politics to migration and participated in diversity conferences and Model United Nations. But when the time came for me to choose where I would go for university, I felt a little lost. Would I follow my dream of making movies one day or stick to my newfound passions for sociology and politics? Thankfully, I was lucky to find the dual BA program between Sciences Po and Columbia University, which allowed me to do both. And so I set off on an adventure and I studied the social sciences in the south of France for 2 years and film finally in New York for 2 years. During my second year in university, I had the luck of attending the Cannes Film Festival for the first time with a team from a film agency based in Cairo. With their Arab Cinema Center initiative, I helped them promote Arab cinema throughout the festival. It was an eye-opening experience for me that helped me form my mission and realize how I could combine my passions for film and politics. I realized that as an Egyptian growing up abroad, I never saw myself represented in the movies that I was watching. And it never occurred to me just how much that impacted me, including how I would straighten my hair to look like the girls I saw in the movies. And whenever I did see people who looked like me or spoke my native tongue of Arabic, they were often relegated to the roles of villains. And I could see the devastating impact that was having on the community around me. When I entered the industry, I realized that that issue also existed behind the camera. Often, when I would be on a set, I would look around and I would realize that I was one of the only women and definitely one of the only Arab or African women present. But what if we started using film as a way to reflect the diversity of our world? And those are the movies that I want to make.
What an inspiring conversation. Now I really want to visit Egypt. IFC is doing business all around the world and has led impactful projects across Africa. Our regional vice president for Africa, Sergio Pimenta, will share more on our work and vision. As the VP for Africa, he's in charge of more than 700 staff working on development challenges in the financial, manufacturing, agribusiness and services, and infrastructure industries.
Welcome to UpNext, Inside Africa's Creative Industries. African countries have embarked on the road to recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic. This provides an opportunity to create a stronger, more resilient, and more connected continent by working across the public and private sectors. IFC's goal in Africa is to partner with the private sector to address development challenges and create opportunities. We aim to increase access to electricity and broadband internet, respond to climate change to operate more sustainably, enable small businesses to grow, reduce gender gaps, and empower more young people to thrive. Across Africa, young people are entering the job market. They're ready to build a new future for Africa, leveraging new technologies and harnessing their creative energy and ideas. If given access to critical services, to new technologies, and to digital economy, Africa's youth will be empowered to boost the continent's growth and to find new opportunities to create employment. The creative industry is a powerful partner that can support Africa's development, from creating jobs and employment to creating narratives through films, stories, visuals, and performances that inspire others to see the continent's successes today and possibilities for tomorrow. So thank you for attending today's exciting event. I look forward to being inspired. I hope you enjoy hearing from some of the continent's leading creative minds.
Thank you, Sergio. It's great to hear about what IFC is currently doing, what the future holds for our business in Africa. anybody wants to learn more about what we're doing or want to check out some job opportunities, head over to ifc.org.
In the next segment, we'll talk about fashion, visual arts, and more. We'll have storytelling and conversations with some of Africa's brightest creatives. Let's go to Nigeria, where we'll speak to Amanda Dara, a TV host, model, rising actress, who will share her experience with us. Welcome to Dara Naturals Spa. My name is Amanda Dara and I'm the CEO of Dara Naturals and of course Dara Group. You're here today somewhere in Lekki Phase 1. Just like every other thing, the beauty line is a very, very big market. I believe that there is room to invest in places like this, SMEs that want to actually do something different in the skincare line and actually have a message, a strong message that they're pushing as well, which is promoting the African beauty, which is also saying no to toxic products, saying no to bleaching, and actually saying that you should love your skin tone just the way it is. So it's very hard to actually expand the way you should because of funding. So investors should look into that, not just because they are also promoting like a message, but because it's also very profitable. You can see that with social media, you can do a lot. A lot of people are trying to be content creators. They want to own their own content. They want to do their own skits. They want to do their own movies. Well, just like we keep saying, they don't have access to funds. So the private sectors, people who are passionate about the industry, the media industry, say, you know what, I want to get a bunch of young guys and we're going to do something amazing. You'll be shocked how far this could go. Our music industry has already gone so far. It's international right now. And so why can't our TV presenting industry in that aspect of the media industry go as far? Why can't acting go as far? So we need as much push as possible. We can't wait for the government to do this one. The creative industry has changed my life because I was an introvert, just wanting to do my own thing. And here I was being thrown into a platform. Currently, my TV show has 1.2 million viewers and counting every single day. And these are people that are watching. These are people that are fans. These are people that want to be a part of my life. They want to be a support system. I've been able to set up, just like you're seeing, my spa because I have opportunities to do jobs, you know? So it's all like a domino effect where, oh, they watch you on TV and then they want you to do external jobs. And then you have money, which can now set up a place like this. So it has really changed the course of my life. And I'm really excited and happy that I chose that path to actually showcase what I love to do. I believe that these conversations are very important because it showcases how creative we can be in the industry. It showcases what we love to do, our passions. It also talks about some of the challenges we're facing. And it also says that we're being seen, we're being heard, and we are being understood, and help is coming. So definitely these conversations are very, very important. And kudos to you guys for doing this amazing project. Looking forward to seeing many more creatives like myself. Thank you.
Right from 2011, when 2005, when I started posting my work on the internet, so I usually use Facebook. But over the period of 5 or 10 years now, I started putting my work on internet, and it gets a lot of attention and public attention, and people started seeing that there's something important this guy is doing in Africa. so that they should kind of promote him. So, and in 2016, I posted a painting. I was about doing my second solo then. I posted a painting and it went viral. All the old social media and all media international outlet tried to carry it because they feel something unique, very, very unique and very, very good. So they tried to like expand it, the publicity to where it is today. And the sky is the limit for me in that area. There are so many things that the art industry can benefit from and we can do, considering the fact that art has been less appreciated in Africa. But there are so many things the private sector and the public, the government can do to enhance the youth and the culture in arts. I can point that there are so many building infrastructural aspects whereby the government can do by creating a good museum where people can, where artists can create an historical artwork that can tell the story of Africa. And at the end of the day, they preserve those works in that area. So if there is nothing like that, there is no way the artist can look up to one particular place where he wants his heart can reach and people can come all over the world to see what our history and heritage is all about. So if those infrastructure are being put in place, I think and a little funding from government as well for so many young artists that are out in the streets that they cannot get money to buy those expensive materials. So I think those little funding can help a lot of creative young ones to develop their talent and tell the African story by themselves. So without anybody outside the world telling their story for them.
Started as a dream. It started as a childhood dream. I think from 8 years old to 17 years old, I really used to make garments for dolls, for creatures, etc. And I feel like what has enhanced my love for fashion is the fact that the people that I loved were really supportive about it. So that's how it all started, as a dream as a kid. And I forgot about it a few years and I came back to it in 2008. That's the story. Sustainability is even more important today that we saw the consequences of our reckless behavior with what we have, where we live, and the generosity that the alive has towards us. But I think today it's a matter of rising in humanity and understanding that we are part of the living. There is no nature and human. We are all part of the same system, and that anything that suffers around us makes us suffer as well. So I think as a business, it's really important to take that into account and to cultivate that level of awareness, responsibility, and just honesty. Film brought me to fashion, and then fashion started to bring me to film. I think it really started in 2014 with my collection Alien Cartoon, where I had the occasion to just create an immersive experience for people in Dakar, at Dakar's train station.
And we reproduced an alien village where you had creatures, music, architecture, everything was like a full decorum dedicated to the collection. And I wrote a short story for it, actually. And I think since that day, stories became an obsession. I wanted to tell them, I wanted to live again the fact that a story could have such an impact on people's imagination. And that's what I like the most about the stories, is that it has the capacity to go so deeply into people's souls. And I really want to be political about mine. I think it's a great thing that so many new platforms of high quality exist for brands on the continent. And I am really admirative of the way they valorize everything that is made here and everything that is made in Africa. The main problem is a problem of access to other markets. Today, if I have to export garments to sell them on any platform, I need to send stock. And by sending stock, I'm paying such a large amount of money to make sure that the items are available in another space, that at some point you just ask yourself, is it really worth it? And if you are really, really high end, it is. But if you have production that is not that expensive and you have to pay in tax, sometimes the amount of the product that you're sending is not really worth it. So I think it's a matter of taxation, access to markets. Those are the things that we really need to focus on. And even before that, you know, on the chain of fashion in Senegal, for example, there are many other problems before even the product is available and ready to be sent that make it difficult to connect the dots between us, production, distribution, and the e-commerce platform. So there's actually a lot of work to do. Structurally, African fashion has produced and polluted less the earth than, and we were in some type of slow fashion culture, because that's where our industry was. So I think there's something very valuable to keep about that, slowing the pace, making sure that we add value and that the way our products add value in the lives of the people we sell it to doesn't take away life from our environments and doesn't take away life from the people that work for us. So I think there's a lot of things that finally can be considered as positive. The industry is at a certain level. I think it's important to bring it up, because it gives employment. It's a huge sector here, but we should keep in mind that the objective is not inundating the earth with millions and billions of products. There's something beyond that, and that's what's interesting to me. A quick tip is to be bold about it. Go to the market, choose your fabric, be very intentional about it, and look at your body, see how you want to be seen by the world, what you want to project, and go to a tailor, make that garment. That's for people that have access to tailor and that can have their garments be sewn for a little budget. And for the others, I think you have to just to be creative, go to thrift stores, don't put any limits, and combine a style that is beyond brands, beyond stamps, beyond names, but that is really who you are as a person. That's the tip.
Hello à tous, j'espère que vous allez bien. Je suis Diana Pouli, créatrice de contenu UpNext. Petite, j'ai toujours été une grande fan d'art. À 7 ans, 8 ans, je faisais déjà du tricot, je concevais des petits vêtements pour mes poupées. Et pour le petit côté comique de ma personne, j'imitais les mimiques des autres. Ça faisait trop rire. Quand quelqu'un avait une mimique assez spéciale, j'essayais d'imiter et ça amusait plutôt bien la galerie. En grandissant, j'ai fini mes études secondaires et supérieures. J'ai décidé de faire de la création de contenu mon métier, parce que cet amour pour l'art a été de plus en plus grandissant. J'ai commencé par être modèle photo, mannequin photo, je suis toujours d'ailleurs. Ensuite, j'ai découvert des applications comme TikTok qui m'ont permis vraiment d'étendre mon art, que ce soit dans la comédie, la mode, le chant, la danse et même l'art plastique, parce que oui, tout cet écosystème artistique-là me concerne et font de moi ce que je suis aujourd'hui. Oh, quand j'ai atteint 1 million, c'était comme des feux d'artifice. J'étais dans un état, j'arrivais pas à y croire. Je ressens tellement de gratitude envers ces personnes. Vous vous rendez compte? 1 million de personnes, c'est 1 million d'audimats. Dans mon cas, j'ai été virale en 2 phases. La première phase, c'était la partie Afrique et diaspora africaine. C'était grâce aux reprises des chansons de l'époque. Voilà, je me mettais dans la peau des grands chanteurs, pas forcément à les caricaturant, sauf quelquefois quand je voulais apporter le côté nostalgique, même comme il y avait toujours le côté nostalgique quand on réécoutait ces chansons. C'était vraiment énorme. Tout le monde en parlait, tout le monde m'en redemandait encore. Et pour la deuxième phase, c'était le boom. C'était grâce à la vidéo « Qui veut être un roi ?». C'est-à-dire, je me suis retrouvée le lendemain à être relayée par tout le monde dans tous différents pays. Je ne comprenais même pas. Des grands youtubeurs de partout et mon téléphone et surtout le téléphone de mon management sonnait tout le temps avec des grandes entreprises de partout, des grands médias. Moi, j'arrivais pas à y croire. Qui veut être un roi? Je fais l'annonce en disant, les amis, je vais coudre mes propres tenues pour le challenge. Qui veut être un roi? La vidéo a fait 1 million de vues. C'est là que je me suis rendu compte que les gens attendent. Les réseaux sociaux, je dis, sont clairement un outil pour les entreprises et les organisations. Parce que aujourd'hui, par exemple, nous, les créateurs de contenu, nous avons une communauté. Une communauté qui pourrait être la cible de ces différentes entreprises et organisations. Aujourd'hui, les réseaux sociaux représentent un réel impact pour les entreprises qui veulent atteindre leurs objectifs commerciaux et marketing. Aujourd'hui, je suis la preuve vivante qu'à base d'un téléphone, de la passion et beaucoup de discipline personnelle, on peut faire beaucoup de choses. Négligez pas vos capacités, parce que chacune de vos capacités est une bénédiction pour le monde.
Hello, my name is Tolumide and I am a singer-songwriter, performing artist based in Washington, D.C. Excited that you can listen to my song entitled Your Arms, Funmilayo. Funmilayo is a Yoruba name and it means you give me joy. Ayo means joy. And I was suddenly thinking of that when I wrote this song. So Hope you enjoy it, and I hope you connect with me online at tolumidemusic.com so I can hear from you and I can keep you posted with more music to come. I call my music Suyaso because it's music from my heart. But my heart, deep in my heart, you know, is positive, it's inspiring, it's and it's spicy as well. So there's a bit of Suya, Suya, you know, seasoning on it, you know, to really, you know, showcase where I'm coming from, which is really trying to, you know, showcase my, you know, my African flavor in soul music. So look forward to hear from you. Enjoy. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for listening. This is Tolumide signing out. Bye.
My sweetie, my lovely, I cannot believe that you're standing here in front of me. Whoa, whoa, you're my everything.
You're my everything. Give me your life.
There was a time I didn't think that I could ever be loved so much by someone like you. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Tolumide, and I am a singer-songwriter, performing artist based in Washington, D.C. Excited that you can listen to my song entitled Your Arms, Fumilayo. Fumilayo is a Yoruba name, and it means you give me joy. Ayo means joy. And I was certainly thinking of that when I wrote this song, so hope you enjoy it, and I hope you connect with me online at tolumidemusic.com so I can hear from you and I can keep you posted with more music to come. I call my music Suyaso because it's music from my heart. But my heart, deep in my heart, you know, is positive, it's inspiring, it's and it's spicy as well. So there's a bit of Suya, Suya, you know, seasoning on it, you know, to really, you know, showcase where I'm coming from, which is really trying to, you know, showcase my, you know, my African flavor in soul music. So look forward to hear from you. Enjoy. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for listening. This is Tolumide signing out. Bye.
My sweetie, my lovely, I cannot believe that you're standing here in front of me. Whoa, whoa, you're my everything.
You're my everything. Give me all I need.
There was a time I didn't think that I could ever be loved so much by someone like you.
I cannot resist the love you give me in your arms.
satisfy me in your arms. Oh yes, in your arms.
Wow, what a powerful message coming from these creatives and entrepreneurs moving the needle in their fields. I feel so inspired by the energy and insight we've been able to get from all the speakers so far. And we are not done yet, there is more to come. My name is Fatoumata Diané. I'm an investment officer covering the Africa region at IFC, and I'll be your host for the final part of this event. We'll be joined by IFC's managing director, Makhtar Diop, and YouTube's head of music for Africa, Adi Awofisayo, for a live discussion. Of course, we want to keep you engaged in the conversation. I've already seen a lot of comments and activity in the live chat. Please keep them coming. And if you have any burning questions you would like to ask Makhtar or Adi, please share them in the live chats. Before we get to that, as we hope to do this again and better, we would love to hear your feedback on this event. So please take a moment to respond to the poll that will appear on the platform shortly. While you do that, let's connect with Bisola Denloye, who is part of a multidisciplinary group at IFC, working to intensify our efforts to drive more investment in the creative economy. Bisola, I'd love to hear some of your takeaways from the events.
Hi, Fatoumata. Thank you so much for the introduction. I have to say, it's really been great to have traveled virtually today, all the countries we've been to, DC, Dakar, Lagos, Joburg, and you know, just really getting up close and personal with some of the industry leaders and new entrants doing amazing work on the continent. I think it's really great to have gotten a bird's eye perspective, you know, on the opportunities as well as some of the challenges that are ahead for us in the creative industry. I guess as a woman of African origin, I really identified with themes on representation and the importance of storytelling. So I noticed a lot of our panelists, for example, Haya, you know, the Egyptian filmmaker, you know, in her story of not having seen herself represented in some of the movies she was watching, really, you know, for me, reiterated the need and the impetus for us to tell, you know, our own stories, especially for Africans, you know. So I guess I said that to say that the creative industry really plays a role in driving social change. And to be quite honest, like just thinking about it, I feel really, really blessed, you know, to work for an organization such as the IFC, you know, who is really championing the youths to see how we can really play a now more active role in moving this industry forward.
Indeed, IFC really intends to increasingly engage with the next generation. And I want to take this opportunity to thank the IFC Next Gen team who curated this event for us. Also, special thanks to the event sponsor, Bill Sonneborn, and everyone else at IFC and externally who contributed in any way to present such a stellar lineup of African creatives. The NextGen initiative aims to put IFC at the heart of youth conversations in development. And today's event also highlighting the potential of the creative industries as a significant source of job creation and financial inclusion for the youth is part of that vision. Thank you, NextGen! And back to you, Bisola. You are working with colleagues internally to look at ways to drive more investment in the creative economy. Can you touch on a little bit more as to why you think an organization like IFC should be more active in that space?
Good question. And echoing what you said, you know, it's just job creation. I mean, of course, there's more to it than job creation, but I feel that, you know, the creative industry really has the potential to be a really large job reservoir, especially, you know, given the surge in demographic growth and youth unemployment in the Africa region. So it's quite interesting. A few days ago, I came across a post by Mary Njoku, who's the founder of Rock Studios in Nigeria, one of the leading production houses in Nigeria. And she was speaking about Nollywood, but I feel what she says really applies, you know, to the whole industry. I'm not quoting her post verbatim, but, you know, it went along the lines of Nollywood is Nigeria's number one rehabilitation center. She is, you know, a dumping ground to all of the unemployables. She holds your hand until you find your fit in society. She gives a clean slate to anyone, you know, who wants a second, a third, or a fourth chance. So, you know, we watched Mo Abodu, and, you know, she spoke about transitioning into the creative space at 40. Some people thought she was having a midlife crisis. Today, you know, she's the first African woman to be an Oscar member as a producer, you know, so for me, that's inspiring. It's never too late to make a move, right? And, you know, we heard Martha Hura speak, you know, the Boomplay MD in Africa. She said it quite succinctly. Developing the creative industry translates to solving the challenge of global poverty. And for me, you know, when we think of the improved outcomes from a social cohesion perspective, from educational outcomes, you're taking those previously unemployed and you're getting them to be a force for good. As an investor in emerging markets, you know, I have to say, I'm sold. So Fatoumata, what was one thing about the event that really excited you?
Well, I am a music enthusiast, and I must say, Salty Soul's intervention took me down memory lane to the time when I was based in IFC's Nairobi office. They may not remember this, but they took me on stage with them once at one of their performances. I was in this belief that I was on stage with the number one band in the country. I think I might be posting a photo of this on Twitter just after the event. So if you guys want to see it for yourself, feel free to check out our Twitter feed at hashtag IFC up next.
No way. That is super cool. And I will definitely check it out. You know, I was thinking about it. On my side, I've always dreamed of acting in an Hollywood movie for some reason.
Well, Bisola, as we learn from the stories of creatives like Mo Abudu today, dreams can become reality. Thank you, Bisola, for sharing your impressions and takeaways from today's discussion so far.
Thank you, Fatoumata, for having me. It's been a pleasure.
So before we welcome our guests, let's see again what the creative industries can do with this clip.
If I had the chance to save the world, I would give it all I had. If I had the chance to change the world, I would do it with my heart on my hands. Watch me fly, watch me try, watch me be the greatest I can be on my own. I don't really care who's watching me, I'll be fine. I'll be fine, I'll be fine, yeah. Watch me fly, watch me try, watch me be the greatest I can be on my own. I don't really care who's watching me, I'll be fine. I'll be fine, I'll be fine, yeah. A chance to change the world, I would let you know utaku wa sawa. If I had a chance to save the world, I would give it up for anything I have. Watch me fly, watch me try, watch me be the greatest I can be on my own. I don't really care who's watching me, I'll be fine. I'll be fine, I'll be fine, yeah. Watch me fly, watch me try, watch me be the greatest I can be on my own. I don't really care who's watching me, I'll be fine. I'll be fine, I'll be fine, yeah. Watch me fly, watch me try, watch me be the greatest I can be on my own. I don't really care who's watching me, I'll be fine. I'll be fine, I'll be fine, yeah. Thank you.
research, I watch your documentaries. I have some ideas on distribution. Can we talk?
It is now time to welcome our guests for the final section of the event. We have the honor of having Makhtar Diop, IFC's Managing Director, and as we've heard today, a music enthusiast, back with us again. We're also joined by Adi Awofisayo, YouTube's Head of Music for Africa. Welcome, Makhtar. Welcome, Adi. Thank you for joining us. We have about 30 minutes together. To the audience watching us, as a reminder, you also have the opportunity to engage in this conversation and ask questions to Makhtar and Adi. I will be monitoring the live chat to tailor some of my questions during the discussion. So please get your questions and reflections ready and post them in the live chat. I would like to open the discussion with you, Makhtar. When you joined IFC earlier this year, one of the things that stood out is that you came with the target to really think differently about development and about reaching new audiences and new businesses that are not necessarily within IFC's traditional reach. What informed this thinking? And more specifically, why the emphasis on creative industries and why now?
Now, thank you so much. I mean, this experience is based on my own life and my own experience. It took me 20 years ago, 20-something years ago, when I was Minister for Finance, actually, I did something for the creative industry, which kind of surprised people in my among my colleagues. I suggested that we remove all the tax on instruments, musical instruments, and there were the World Bank at the time, which had a project in Senegal on private sector development, and I've asked to put a component on the creative industry, which led to improving copyrights and the governance of the Copyright Association in Senegal. And the reason why I did it is that it was clear for me that creative industry have a huge impact on job creation. And it was the way also to help the youth to express their creativity and to express their entrepreneurship. At that time, you have a lot of hip hop bands, rap bands, which were appearing in Senegal, and we're trying to take it to the next level. I was struggling with basic things like buying a PC, having equipment, and we're struggling with the fact that the copyright laws were not allowing them to get all the benefit of it. So this is my own experience, and as some of you know, I'm passionate about music. I have a lot of friends in that industry, and that informed me about it, and I wanted to use that in my work at IFC and give opportunities to support what is the private sector by essence, which is a creative industry.
Thank you, Makhtar. You're absolutely right. There is a massive opportunity here. And specifically for the music industry, there are reports that tremendous growth is expected in Africa. For example, revenue from digital streaming is expected to multiply fivefold to reach $500 million by 2025. Adi, what is your perspective on this growth and impact story? I also see a question from the live chat asking you, what do you predict might happen in the next 5 to 10 years?
I just want to say thank you first for having me. I'm very excited to be here, and it's exciting to see the number of people tuned in. I think the creative industry in Africa is definitely booming. I don't even think we've reached the pinnacle yet. It's just starting. We're just scratching the surface. And I think because of the youth potential, the young people on the continent, I mean, more than what, 70% of people in Africa are less than 25-year-old. So that just tells you how much potential not only the market has for the creative space, but how much export potential there is. I think for music specifically, the export factor has probably been the sweet spot for Africa, right? And the diaspora. So whether that is Anglophone Africa, where you have the diaspora in the US, in the UK, or Francophone, where it's, you know, exporting into France, I think the export factor for the music industry in Africa has been the sweet spot. Like, you would go to a club in the US and you would hear Wizkid or Burna Boy, and you go to a bar in France and you would hear Yemi Alade. So it's just really exciting. And I think because of that export factor, we're only going to see go up. I think the world is really just catching up with the amazing music that's coming out of the continent. And I think it's really the next generation that's also going to blow it out, right? So music, whether it started with Fela Kuti days or D'Banj and now Wizkid, and now you're looking at, you know, Rema and Ira Starr or CK. CK, who now has probably the biggest song in the world now with Love One Tin Tin. I don't think you can open, you know, TikTok or Instagram and watch a video and not hear that song. And it's just exciting. And I think also because of the digital platforms, music is now easy to cross boundaries, right? Before, you would have to take a CD and maybe, you know, ship it with a friend or have a friend who's traveling to the US take a CD so they can listen to music. Now, whether it's YouTube or other streaming platforms, anyone across the world can listen to any type of music that they want. So I think both the youth population, the digital, oh, my power just went out. African problems. I'm in South Africa right now. I don't know what happened, but my power just went out. But
the youth population, it's live now.
The youth population, the diaspora, and digital platforms, I think, is a big contributor to African music just continuing to grow.
Thank you, Adi. And let's talk a little bit more about your role at YouTube. You were instrumental to a few initiatives, such as the launch of the YouTube Music Premium in Nigeria, as well as a hugely popular Africa Day concert, which was hosted by Idris Elba just earlier this year. You've been spearheading initiatives to support the growth of creators in Africa, such as Next Up Sub-Saharan Africa. Can you give us some insight on YouTube's strategy for the continent? Anything exciting African creators can look forward to? And how do you circumvent issues like access to internet and limited credit card use?
Yes, I feel like you asked like four questions in one, so let me take it one at a time. So just a little bit about me and my role. So I'm actually in a new role now, only about 2 months. But before this role, I was looking after content partnerships for Sub-Saharan Africa. So that is working with our creator ecosystem and also working with media companies like a multi-choice. So for the creator ecosystem, it was about how do we make YouTube a central part of a creator's business? You know, a lot of creators sometimes just start because either they're bored or they're jobless, they don't have a job, they just finished school and they need time, you know, they have time on their hands. But slowly it becomes a business. Slowly it becomes, you know, a lot of creators now, the content creation is their job. That's their livelihood. That's the only thing that they do. So my role at YouTube was to make sure that we were providing resources, we were educating creators, and making YouTube very central to their digital business. Same thing with the media companies, you know, with a multi-choice or a Channels TV. Channels TV is, you know, I think one of the most subscribed news channel in Nigeria with over 1 million subscribers. Their YouTube channel is the way they reach the diaspora who are looking for news from Nigeria, from the continent. So working with them again to make YouTube very central to their business as a whole. And, you know, like you said, in that role, I implemented initiatives such as Africa Creator Week, which was our scaled way of educating over 1,000 creators across Africa. And even 1,000 is like literally a pinch compared to the amount of creators that we have on the continent. And yeah, so then I moved to the music team, because I think like Makta said, I'm passionate about music. And so when the role came up, I said, why not? And I think this is the right time to be in the music space in Africa. It's exciting. It's blowing up. There are just a lot of good things that are to come. So I wanted to take that role, and things like Africa Day concert with Idris Elba was our way of showcasing African music to the world, and really showcasing the world what African artists have to offer. Your question about data, I mean, I think all digital platforms, data is the biggest barrier to getting users on the platform. because, you know, we say it all the time, if data is not a barrier, when we look at India with something they call the geo effect, where literally internet became super, super cheap for people in India, they had a mass number of people come online. And we're not there yet in Africa. Like, internet is still quite expensive for the average person. And so when we get to that stage where internet is not as expensive, we would see digital platforms would see the maximum potential that Africa can offer. Right now, we do have deals with telcos. So we work with MTN, with Airtel, with Nine Mobile, with Vodacom to provide what we call video data plans. So which is like discounted bundles for people so that they can, you know, access YouTube. And that's kind of one of our ways of just addressing that barrier to entry.
Thank you, Addy. YouTube has undoubtedly become an essential platform for creatives and consumers of African content like myself. We've also heard today the amazing work that other companies like Spotify and Boomplay are doing to elevate African content and creators, as you're doing, leading to job creation. So linking this perhaps to the topic of sustainable development, Maktar, you've just been to COP26, and I'm sure you've had great discussions with many stakeholders. Before that, already at IFC's flagship Sustainability Exchange, in your discussion with Don Cheeto, you commented that there are no big changes in recent history where art and storytelling did not play a role. So in your view, how can creatives and industry leaders, such as YouTube, be more involved in that space as allies for sustainable development?
I do think that, let me maybe step back a little bit on some of the points that were made and the constraints to the development of creative art in Africa. I do think that there will be a very big evolution in the way art and creative art has been presented and shared through the world. Digital platform is becoming essential. And that's why in IFC, we are making a big effort to be able to bring much more broadband access to countries. And I think bringing that broadband access and building data centers in Africa, whereby the content we don't have to go back to Europe or the US before channel it back to Africa, but be linked to fiber optic loops, will make the content accessible faster and will be able to store it locally and have the solutions of that type that has been described. So the digital infrastructure will be central in doing that. When we talk about digital infrastructure, we talk about energy consumption. And when we talk about energy consumption, we talk about climate change. And that's why I think working towards having data centers which are not polluting, which are using green energy, would be essential in that effort. We had that conversation with Don Cheadle, which is a very strong activist when it comes to climate change. And we talk about climate justice. And I would like to take that opportunity to say that I'm launching next week a podcast on creative industry. And the first guest will be Don Cheadle. And Baba Mal also will be part of that podcast. Soul to Soul also is part of that podcast. Celiera Bican. So some of the people that you saw today will be explaining a little bit more the roles they see of art in creating the social consciousness. There is no episode in the history of the world where art haven't been playing a significant role in shaping people's consciousness, being from the fight against apartheid, from the liberation of independence in Africa, and very many episodes. So I think that not only creative industry are important for telling the story of Africa by Africans, in the word used by Africans, in the language used by African, it's essential. But that is not sufficient. And I think that's why we need to look at regulation to be able to export the content that has been produced in Africa in other parts of the world. So I think that one of the challenges is to increase the value addition of that industry in Africa. For instance, copyright thinks about subtitling some of the Nollywood or movies made in Senegal or Burkina or Fespaco, or name it, subtitle it so that they can be available, ensuring that the distribution process you have African companies also which are involved and African authors that will be important increase in value addition. So creating an ecosystem for me is a key word on this creative industry, and ensuring that the conditions are there for it.
Absolutely. Thank you, Maktar. You mentioned a few things, policy. This really echoes what Soti Sol's Bien-Aimé Baraza said in your conversation earlier today. We also heard from Yoel Kish, Africori's founder and CEO. Yoel noted that investors do not have enough data on the creative industry, the creative economy in Africa. And they challenged IFC to look at the impact of the creative industry in Africa. So taking that feedback, I'd like to turn to Adi and ask you, from your perspective, can you mention to us one thing, one area where you see collaboration, a potential collaboration between development institutions like IFC and global private sector players like YouTube?
Sure. And just to say that Soti Sol was a member of our YouTube Black Voices for Artists earlier this year. They were part of the first cohort. So shout out to Soti Sol. I think just quickly on your point about data. So even though there probably isn't like mass level of data, but there is, you know, creators themselves have access to their own data that they can use to showcase their reach when it comes to talking to brands. So on YouTube and even on like other social media platforms, you have access to what is called like your analytics. So you can see who your audience are, you can see even what age group your audience is, you can see what gender, you can see where your audience is tuning in from. And that level of information, like it's always so surprising when I talk to some creators and I say, have you looked at your analytics? And they're like, my what? I'm like, your analytics, like your creator studio, have you looked at your data? And then I do a quick, you know, preview and I show them and they're wild because they just never looked at it. But by the time they look at it, they're so informed about, because that, you know, that data, that information gives them critical information about their audience, about their content, you know, when did people drop off and things like that. So I think, you know, if there are creators, you know, listening, always, you know, whatever platform you're using, you do have access to data that can help inform you in terms of your audience and just like how people are consuming your content. And then to your point about, you know, the IFC and Google and how we can collaborate, I just had a call with a private company that I won't mention now, but it was about what can we do together for the creative economy in Africa. And we have access to creators and to artists because we, you know, they use our platform and we work with them. But it's the organizations, the community organizations that are working on training, that are working on development, that we want to support because they can help us reach scale. There's only so much YouTube, a team of two or three people covering Africa can do. But there are a lot of organizations in these countries that are in communities educating young people about the creative space, and it's supporting those organizations. So an IFC is, you know, funding those organizations, providing resources to those organizations so that they can scale and do what they're doing more and expand to more communities. And I think that's so needed. You know, recently we were thinking about organizations in different countries and trying to see like, oh, who are the organizations working on the music ecosystem to support emerging artists or even to support people who want to be managers who want a profession in the music industry, but not necessarily be an artist. And there wasn't a lot that we found. There wasn't a lot. It was either maybe one person who has a passion that's doing it on their own dime. And so, you know, organizations like ours and private sector need to support those types of community organizations.
Thank you, Adi. Maktar, turning back to you, do you have any reaction to Adi's comments just now? I also see the live chat, but there's a lot of questions that are turning around. What are IFC's immediate plans and objectives to support the creative industries? Perhaps you can tell us a little bit more about that. We know you're passionate about this industry. You're a music fan. So we hope to see strong support from IFC.
Yeah, I mean, the first thing is to know the industry and to know the ecosystem. So, for instance, I think that it never happened before. I will be traveling to Nigeria in December, And what never happened is a meeting with the creative industry. So I intend to ask my team to organize a round table, a dinner, a lunch where I can meet some actors of the creative industry. Because knowing a little bit about it is not as simple as one can think from outside. You need to understand some of the constraints. And the constraints are manifold. I know that it's an industry where the success rate also depends on a lot of sub-factors. It's not everybody who is an artist will be becoming someone who would having a platinum disc. So there are some element of risk management that needs one to have to do to be able to help the investors to put more money. One of the things is to aggregate and to have a label to aggregate so that you balance the risk of those who will be having a platinum and those maybe will not be having a platinum, not because they are not less talented, but just because that's the rule of the business. But we talked a lot about music. Even though I'm passionate about music, creative industry goes far beyond music. And I think that there is an area where Africa is doing well, which is the movie industry. Nollywood is something that is quite impressive. You have now also something similar which is being developed in Senegal, in Cote d'Ivoire. And I think that there is an opportunity of creating an ecosystem and to be very ambitious. Let me give you an example. I read recently that there is an island, a French island, which want now to create a condition to attract Hollywood and European filmmakers to use the scenery of the island as being the place where they'll be shooting a lot of scenes in their country. I think that we need to create an ecosystem. And to do that, you need to make sure that when those people who are filmmakers are going there, they will have technicians who can help them on doing things. They will have studio to do the work, and they will have the ecosystem so that they can do a certain number of things. So we need gradually to move towards that, to have a musician who starts specializing in film music, which is different from writing a score for a music hit. So there is a level of specialization that will come as the industry come, including the management of artists, or management of all things. So create that ecosystem for me, it would be very important to make it as robust as resident. So concretely, what I will be doing is meeting with people, listen to them, what are your problems, try to see if you can partner with other entities which are specialized in part of segment of the creative industry, copyright, training of musician, music schools, writing down some of the music on scores to make it available, or a certain number of things that are going with, and try to partner with all of them and see how we can help the industry to develop and to grow. So that's my commitment. And this is what, when my colleagues were asking me something that I would like us to be, is development cool. I think that development has to be cool, has to be interesting, has to be attracting to you. And I think that if you want to talk to the youth in our countries, sports and creative industry are two important means to interact and understand and listen and see how we can respond to their need.
Thank you, Maktar. We've heard your commitment, your action items, and we'll be watching this space. So we're getting close to the end of our time together. So to wrap this up, could you perhaps, you, Adi, if there's one thing you would like this audience to take away from this event, what would it be? I'll maybe give the floor to Adi first, our guest, and then you'll follow Maktar as a final word.
Yeah.
Adi, over to you.
Yeah, I'm just thinking one thing I want them to take away. I think there's so much opportunity.
Adi,
can you hear me?
Your sound is over now. Perfect.
Oh, okay, great. I think there's so much opportunity in the creative space. And we're, I think, like I said at the beginning, we're barely scratching the surface. I think one opportunity that I have seen just again in working with creators is the need for an ecosystem that supports creators, right? So, and when I say an ecosystem, I'm saying, a need for a manager, a need for a brand person, a need for a PR person, like, companies that actually their work is to support the creators in this space. because when you look at the music ecosystem, artists usually would have a label, or they would have, you know, a manager that supports them. But when you are talking to creators, again, because some of them started this by chance and then they get so big, but they, you know, even from understanding the law and, you know, signing a contract with a brand, a lot of creators would just, how much are you paying me? Okay, $10,000. And they'll sign, not understanding and not reading the, you know, the fine print. So I think, you know, we need to start thinking of how to develop the ecosystem to provide resourcing to creators, to provide support to the creators, from knowledge to learning to representation, because that's what's going to make the creative ecosystem continue to grow.
Thank you, Addy. That is definitely a lot to think about. Over to you, Maktar, for final words.
Yeah, final words is that, first of all, I think it's really important to have this conversation because we need to make the African artist community know more about each other. I lived in East Africa and I'm from Senegal, so I can contrast a little bit. It's not clear that there is a lot of exchange between this part of Africa. I'm not sure that you have a lot of collaboration with it. So I think collaboration will be an important part because I think that there are a lot of good things which are happening in different parts of the continent, but we are not shared widely to be able to scale it to the level that where it make a difference. So I think that the initiatives that you took to have this conversation should be pursued, should be developed, and try a regular forum where people can have that conversation and bring some concrete proposals to at the table that would be able to reach a lot of people. Secondly, as the industry will be maturing, a level of specialization will happen, and that conversation will be important because you know, it's not in more mature market in music, you have people who are doing arranging the music, people who are lyricists, people who are composers of melodies, people who are interpreters. Okay, in the continent, it's very rare that you have all these level of specialization. One artist is a little bit everything at the same time. So as we go, you will have profession will be developing, and we need to start preparing and work with the public sector, because you have school in a public school on this area. Try to see how we can link them to professionalize that industry and subsidize it. Last thing is that we are here to learn. I'm not here to pretend to know it all and say, okay, guys, do 1, 2, 3. I'm really very interesting and exciting in learning. And whenever I travel, I will try to link up with the creative industry whenever my agenda allows, so that I learn more about it and we will be able. Lastly, we have a disruptive technology unit, which is starting already working on it. And I know that in the group of the next generation IFC, some people have already started some contact, and I know that it will bear fruit. So very much excited to be part of it, and to you to help me keeping young at heart, at least, because this is a place where you need to be young at heart if you want to be part of the movement.
We can certainly do that for you, Maktar. I hope this inspires all of us to think about how we can play a role. Thank you for these final words, Maktar and Addy. It's been a pleasure having you both with us today. This has been an amazing experience. We are so grateful to you, to all of our amazing speakers, to all of our artists. We cannot wait to do this again with you. For those of you on live stream, thank you for the strong participation today. Please stick around as we share with you a soundtrack by artist Tolumide. Good day and good evening to you all.
My sweetie, my lovely, I cannot believe that you're standing here in front of me. Whoa, whoa, you're my everything.
You're my everything.
There was a time I didn't think that I could ever be loved so much by someone like you. Oh, all the things you do
for me. is find my love in your arms. Yes, in your arms. I cannot resist love, give me in your arms. Oh, satisfy, satisfy me in your arms. Oh, yes, in your arms.
To see the promised land from afar, so beautiful, they don't know who we are. Keep on walking in the way, kuna blessings in the pain, no, no, no.
Rocking on the midnight train,
steady, 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 rocking the land.
Whatever it takes, keep on moving to Zion. Desire, desire.